Hello and welcome. I'm Amritanshu Rai and you're watching Law of the Land on Raj Sabha TV. Today we bring to you the Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Amendment Bill 2011. The bill seeks to include specially abled children for free education. We will also discuss the implication of the Supreme Court judgment making it compulsory for private schools to give free education to the disadvantaged section. To discuss the issue, I have with me Mr. Javed Abidi, Director of the National Centre for Promotion of Employment for Disabled People, and Mr. Pramod Sharma, Director and Principal, Genesis Global School. Now for the headlines. The bill seeks to include children with disability within the definition of a child belonging to disadvantaged group. The proposed amendment will allow grant of free and compulsory education to specially abled children. And the Supreme Court provides for 25% quota for poor students in all private schools except private minority schools. The Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Amendment Bill 2011 seeks to include children with disabilities within the definition of child belonging to disadvantaged group. The proposed amendment seeks to make free and compulsory education a fundamental right for the specially abled child.
Barring schools specifically meant for specially abled children, most of the schools in the private or the government sector do not have the expertise or the will to take on the challenge of educating a specially able child. Even the government seems to have missed including this section in the original act. But now the government wants to correct this. The government intends to expand the definition of children belonging to disadvantaged group to include children with disabilities.
As the reservation is concerned, you are probably aware that still under the RT, this is reservation is for weaker sections,
yes,
and for disadvantaged groups. Yeah?
Yes.
So now still the child with disability is not mentioned under the disadvantaged groups. So because that is one of the proposed amendments that is to come in the Act. Mm. The Act as it stands today, you do not the child with disability is not specifically named under the disadvantaged category.
According to the bill, a child with disability is defined as a child who is without vision, cured of leprosy, hearing impaired, motor disability, and whose brain is affected. It also includes children living with autism, cerebral palsy, and multiple disabilities. Once the bill becomes a part of the law, all children falling under this definition will have the same right as any other child as far as free and compulsory elementary education is concerned. The amendment also provides for a child living with multiple disabilities and severe disability the right to opt for home-based education.
The special school system does not come inside the ambit of the Ministry of Human Resource Development. And therefore, all the standards that we talk about or all the provisioning that there has to be in education is lacking in these schools. Then there are schools for particular kinds of disabilities, and these are solely non-formal run schools, special schools. And that has happened for many, many years. And our big issue at the moment is in today's world, when we have the right to education as a fundamental right, should a certain set of children just be educated in a non-formal way?
The bill also seeks to provide protection of the right of minorities to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. In the proposed law, the school management committees in respect of minority educational institutions shall function only in advisory capacity and they will not be required to prepare school development plan, safeguarding thereby the interest of all minorities, whether based on religion or language. The Right to Education Amendment Bill seeks to include differently abled children, but the concern is the age criteria, which is 6 to 14 years of age only. With camera person Rajdeep, Aruna Thakur, Rajya Sabha TV.
The Parliamentary Standing Committee is of the view that elementary education should not be made compulsory for children with severe or multiple disability. Can opt for home-based education. That's a clause prominently displayed in the bill, and which essentially means that if a child doesn't get any place in the school, and in fact that is what is likely to happen, that they will provide money, a certain amount, to the child at home and expect him to continue as he is.
See, first of all, children are children. Whether you are a non-disabled child or you are a disabled child, all children, all people have the same aspirations. All children have the right to education. Mm-hmm. That's a right which was guaranteed and is guaranteed in the Constitution.
Absolutely.
Unfortunately, it took our country more than half a century, mm-hmm. when 60 odd,
to acknowledge that,
to acknowledge that, and to accept that. Yeah. And even there, an honest analysis, which even your program I saw has done, is that the government has gone wrong twice. But thanks to the intervention and a very firm intervention made by the Prime Minister himself, Mr. Kapil Sibal had no choice but to then go in for amendments. Mm-hmm. But the point is that even in going for the amendments, they are once again making the same mistake that they made in the first round,
yeah.
which is that now they are correcting one mistake on one hand by and bringing children with disability along with the other disadvantaged children, and at the same time leaving an escape route to say that, well, you know, in the name of home schooling,
you stay at home.
Now, we recently had a very high level meeting with the secretary of the concerned department in the Ministry of HRD, and we confronted her on this particular clause to say that, you know, why has this been put in, because this was not in the original amendment.
Original, yes, yes. You
see, this is a net result of the discussions that may have taken place
on the practical implementation side
within the standing committee.
Yes,
there are parents who prefer not to send their child to the school,
yeah.
and they prefer to school the child at home.
Mm-hmm.
So the point is that if a parent wants to exert that right, or if a child wants to exert that right, that is already available to the child.
Yes.
Why do you want to spell it out
the way it has been?
And that also in a statute,
which is written and finalized.
Because then what will happen is that, and I am saying that even today for the Ministry of HRD to go and correct that mistake is a better thing to do than to allow this to go through, because otherwise then this will be abused in the long run by parents, by teachers,
by schools, and by schools, the entire society.
And by the entire society, by the system.
I'll bring in Mr. Sharma on that point. See, the way it has, you yourself have a special school within your campus, and you are practicing it already, trying to integrate specially able children into the mainstream. That's a very, very important beginning, okay? Most of the schools are not doing that. But the point I want you to answer is, do you think there is lack of will to create infrastructure for specially able children in the private sector as well as in the government sector? And who do you think should primarily take the responsibility for creating infrastructure for specially able children?
Ultimately, right to education, we all know 85% of the children do not go to private schools. Only 15% go to the private school. For the 85% of the children to get quality education in government school, what infrastructure in last 3 years or 4 years has been created? I find there is nothing which has happened. It is just wishful thinking that these 15% of the private school or 7 or 8% of the well-run private schools will be able to take 25% of the children, and so all the problems are solved. Mm-hmm. So the same thing is the home, this talk about home
option,
education,
yes,
home education option is also again a wishful thinking option, that since we cannot create, I don't have infrastructure to provide normal children into these school, how will I create infrastructure to provide facilities for special children?
Who in your perception should be responsible for creating infrastructure in the government and the private sector? Should it be the government or should it be the private sector?
The private sector must create infrastructure in private schools. But again, as I said, 85% of India is in government school. And you need to create that infrastructure. Obviously, the responsibility mainly is of government.
On that note, it's time for us to head into a break. When we come back, we will talk about Supreme Court judgment making it mandatory for private schools to give free education to the disadvantaged section. Welcome back. Now, children from economically disadvantaged section will be able to obtain free education in private schools. The Supreme Court in a recent judgment upheld the right of children to free and compulsory education, which provides for 25% quota for poor students in all schools except private minority schools.
If a child who is denied the right to access education is not only being deprived of his right to live with dignity, but also he is deprived of his right to freedom of speech and expression. This is what the Supreme Court judgment on the right to education says.
What's the kind of debate that we have seen in the last few days on the Right to Education Act? Remember, this 80 to 90% of education is provided by government. And it's only a very small percentage of private schools in the elementary arena.
The majority judgment clearly lays down what it intends to achieve. The Supreme Court judgment says the right of children to free and compulsory education act is constitutionally valid and will apply to all schools owned or controlled by the government, that is government schools. The judgment will also apply to aided schools, including aided minority schools, receiving aid or grants to meet whole or part of expenses from the government, that is, government-aided schools. An unaided, non-minority school not receiving any kind of aid from the government, that is, private schools. But the Act will not apply to unaided minority schools due to earlier interpretations of their rights. This section is the private minority schools. The judgment will operate from the academic year 2012 to 2013.
Some issues were raised with regard to the specified schools, very different types of schools which are specified separately. For instance, the minority institutions, the minority schools, madrasas as they are called. That madrasas, whether madrasas are covered within the Right to Education Act or not, this issue was raised time and again. And the government has taken a stand that madrasas could be excluded, although not in totality. Part of madrasa activity will remain where it gains out of the system.
The Apex Court also says the law should be viewed as a child-centric and not institution-centric. The Supreme Court has given the state governments 6 months to notify rules under the clause reserving 25% seats for students from disadvantaged sections under the Right to Education Act. The Supreme Court has also said that the state governments will have to constitute a state advisory council within 3 months. Yet another good example of public interest is well taken by Supreme Court in its recent landmark judgment on RTA Act, which provides 25% reserve seats for the poor children. With camera person Rajdeep, Aruna Thakur, Rajya Sabha TV.
The Supreme Court made it clear in its judgment that admissions given by unaided minority schools prior to the pronouncement of this judgment will not be reopened. But my question to you, Mr. Sharma, is that 25% quota in private schools for all disadvantaged sections, that's a big bag. You are that 15% of institutions, you're part of that 15% institution who will now have to provide compulsory and free education to the disadvantaged section. How do you react?
In Genesis Global School, for example, which I run, I start with breakfast. So as soon as the children come to school, 8 o'clock, 8:15, 8:30, I give them wholesome breakfast and proper breakfast. And then there is a snack, then it's followed by lunch, then 3 o'clock children go home. Now, if I am taking up Plus, I provide so many other facilities. And it's not just the sports, but I'd like to provide sports with the kind of surface which is of international quality. So obviously, all this is extremely expensive. Now, to have 25% children in the school, which will only pay 1,000 rupees, or whatever, little money the government prescribes, is obviously going to create difficulties for the schools to become viable. Maybe the new schools, people will think many times before they open the new school, or think about the plan. How are they going to furnish? We also have to do some soul searching and to cut corners or something without decreasing the quality of food, without decreasing the quality of education that we intend to provide. Yeah. So all that has to be thought of. To give an example, if the government is keen about providing quality education, why does the government auction land for schools? If school education has to be cheap, then why don't you provide school education, or even if you want to auction, for example, you know, first option is to provide concessional rate land. Second option is to, okay, auction it, but all that money that the government is getting from auction, make corpus out of a certain amount and leave it in the school to facilitate the education of these 25% children. So in future, your problem is, you know, the schools do not face that kind of problem. So some out of box thinking needs to be done, and some thinking with the government's government surely consults lots of educators, but consult some newer ones, because the ones you have consulted have got you into this.
Okay, I'll bring Mr. Abidi in. In all this talk, do you think that a specially abled child is not really a part of the definition of child in this country? Do you get that feeling?
Of course. I mean, you see, I'll again share a fact which is not very often highlighted in society and in media, which is that if you talk of minoritism, if you talk of disadvantaged sections of society, all the, you know, fantastic terminologies and phrases that we use, it is children with disabilities who have been the most disadvantaged, who have been the most excluded. And when I say that, I'm saying this on record, and you can cross-check these facts, that as many as 98% to 99% of children with disabilities are out of the school system, are out of the education system. And I repeat it again, that not 70%, not 60%, not 80%, not even 90%, which is very horrific, 98% of children with disabilities do not have access to any kind of education. Private, government, home, special, nothing. We just saw the clipping where the minister admitted that 90% is, I think, what he said, of the children in this country are even today, by hook or by crook, by choice or by default, getting their education from the government machinery. And what is the government doing about it? Now, that is not to say that we absolve the private sector and we absolve the private sector of its responsibility towards either the disadvantaged sections of the society. And quite frankly, I'm not getting into that politics. I mean, the points made are reasonably valid, reasonably sound. My only point always has been that the infrastructure should be accessible. Whether you are the government, whether you are the private sector, when you are going into any kind of a public domain, whether you are a school, whether you are a college, whether for that matter you are an airport or a hospital, your infrastructure
should be made should be
accessible, should be such where any child with disability is able to gain the same education as any other child. Now, whether free or whether with fees or whether with subsidy, that's
separate
for the politicians of the
country. On that note, it's time for us to head into a break. When we come back, we will show you an interview with chairperson of National Trust, Poonam Natarajan. Welcome back. My colleague Aruna Thakur spoke to Poonam Natarajan, chairperson, National Trust, the premier organization to oversee welfare of the specially abled.
The bill covers only the age group of 6 to 14 years. So how do you see this age group criteria?
Actually, for children with disabilities, especially for children with the National Trust, the developmental disabilities, our preference would be to work from 6 to 18 years. Because children with disabilities may take longer to learn, may need more support, may need more resources. And sometimes their disabilities are also identified at a late age. So we really think that they should get a chance to be in the school systems till they're 18 years old.
Recently, the Supreme Court has given a very landmark judgment by allowing 25% quota for the poor children. So how do you see this judgment?
Oh, I'm very excited about it. Because if we are to achieve universal education, then private schools also have to play their role. It has to be both the government schools and the private schools. And the private schools, you see, some of them have a policy of taking children with special needs, some don't have. And the poor child hardly ever gets a chance to actually reach the school. And I think the private schools will benefit when they have a diversity in their school.
I'm coming to the last question, that what is the major pitfall of the proposed amendment in the RTA Act?
You see, I am very disappointed with only the last one, which is home-based education. Actually, it says that children with severe and profound disabilities have a choice for home-based education. Now, that's okay. I mean, since Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan started in 2000, there has been home-based education. But we didn't want it in the law. It was there as a practice, as a policy. That was happening because all kids could not go in, because children with very profound disabilities could not go into mainstream school. But what is happening also, when we say this, there are many children who may come over 80% disability, like children with cerebral palsy. All their four limbs are affected. So they sometimes have 90%, 100% disability, but they're bright. And they can do their 10th standard, they can do their 12th standard. Children with autism can do it. Children with multiple disabilities, they're all doing their exams, and they can be in the mainstream school. So giving this choice in the law is going to be very detrimental to our children, because everybody, the schools will say, you have a choice, and why don't you stay at home?
The Parliamentary Standing Committee proposed that for children with disabilities, the option of going to a school that can cater to their specific needs should be available, irrespective of it being a neighbourhood school or a distance school. But that brings me to Mr. Sharma, again the point relating to the 25% quota. If you give 25% quota in your existing number of seats, what will be the impact?
I find it very strange that government is concerned about those children who did not have access to private education or quality education earlier. So 25% of the seats are reserved for them. Mm-hmm. That's okay. But tell me, who was going into these 25% seats earlier? All the schools in Delhi. Somebody was studying in these seats. Who are these people? These are lower middle class, or whatever segment. Now, what happens to these children, 25%, whose seats have been taken away and have been given to, has the government made a plan? Is there any action, concrete action? Because these schools cannot add 25% of the seats because they are already overcrowded.
Yeah.
So I think this whole thing is a very knee-jerk reaction to me.
That 25% quota includes, if the amendment is approved, will include the section of the specially abled children. Now, there is a huge concern on that front that if the other children who are already going there, 25% of them, where do they go? And if that was to accommodate you and the other disadvantaged section, then who is anyone thinking about the people who've been, the children who've been displaced? Is that a valid concern or not?
Well, it's a valid point to raise to the extent that what Mr. Sharma is saying, that any government, any responsible government, should have a larger plan vis-a-vis education of all children. I mean, that's the underlining thought, whether they are rich children, poor children, disabled, non-disabled, girl,
all children, right? All sections.
Now, quite frankly, I'm not an educationist. Mm-hmm. And I've already said that, thank God, I'm not a politician. Mm-hmm. So therefore, I would not exceed my mandate and try to answer questions which I have
are
not,
beyond your brief.
Which are beyond my understanding. Right? But if you look at it from a disability point of view, and which is what I am here to represent.
Yes.
This amendment of including children with disabilities in the disadvantaged category is going to do a huge service to the cause of the disabled child.
Yes.
Because the reality of the matter is that disabled children were being denied admission in regular schools, not just the hoity-toity private schools, but even the government schools. An average disabled child would go, and because he or she is a wheelchair user, because the school doesn't have the infrastructure, the principal would make faces, would think of excuses, would deny admission. Because the child is blind, because the child is deaf, and God forbid if the child has a more severe disability. That's a harsh, hard, bitter reality of this nation, where children with disabilities were denied admissions, were turned away, were told ki tumhare liye to special schools hain, tum wahan jao, etc., etc., etc. After this amendment, no school, rich, poor,
will be able
neighborhood,
to say that.
Will be able to say that, and the school infrastructure, including the government school infrastructure,
will have to be
will have no choice
to improve,
but to A, give admission to children with disabilities, and obviously, the import of that would be that they would have to then make their services.
All said and done, but there are no infrastructures happening. Even in the government sector, 90%, the infrastructure, despite all this being done, the court giving quota, the RTE amendment coming in, but eventually it's the infrastructure that has to be used. So, is there any thing that needs to be done on that part?
Well, a lot of things would have to be done, and particularly vis-a-vis disabled children. You see, if you look at it from a very layperson's perspective, to include a disadvantaged girl child or to include a disadvantaged whichever other child is not so much of a challenge, only to the extent of economics. But otherwise, the child is a child and will come and will sit in the classroom, etc., etc. But the nation will undergo a lot of turmoil, and I'm so glad that for once it will be you facing that turmoil and not me and not my people, which is to say that now it will be like in your face, now it will be like, ab batao. Because when that child on a wheelchair lands up in the school, when that blind boy or girl lands up in the school, when that deaf boy or girl lands up in that school, the school principal, the school infrastructure
will have no choice but to deal with it. Yes.
So therefore, for us, it is a revolutionary step. And to that extent, we are very excited.
On that note, thank you, sir, for joining us on this discussion. It's time for us to end the show. You can email your suggestions and comments to law.rstv@gmail.com. You can also watch our shows on the YouTube. We'll be back with a new issue and a new episode. Keep watching Rajya Sabha TV.